Hello friends, Dr. Sangeeta with you for another lecture of Dental Pathshala. I really appreciate you guys are taking out time to watch the videos and please leave comments. They're helpful and keep me going and motivated to put more videos. And today's topic is the continuation of orthodontic diagnosis. So previous video we have covered case history. I'll give you a link in the description below if you haven't watched the previous video and up in the I button. So today we'll be starting with the clinical examination and the extra oral examination. It starts before the patients take up a seat in a dental chair. So we should give an attempt to estimate the chronological age or the age of an individual from the height and the build of a patient. Now build is divided into three types. The aesthetic build, wherein the person is having a thin physique and they usually have narrow dental arches. The other physique we have is the plethoric kind of physique. So this one is the patient who are obese, so they have large or squarish dental arches. Now the third one we have is the athletic physique, which is considered to be a normal build. They are not thin or not obese. So they have a normal size dental arches. Shelton divided the general body or the physique into three types, which is the ectomorphic, which is the thin and the tall figure. So this is ectomorphic. The next one is the mesomorphic, or it is similar to the athletic physique, which is neither the thin nor the obese. So they have the average physique and they have the normal dental arches. So this is the mesomorphic. And the third one is the endomorphic, people who are short and obese physique. So these are the endomorphic. So these morphic classification is given by Sheldon. So we determine the journal assessment of a patient by journal examination as soon as the patient enters the clinic. Then extra oral examination is followed by intra oral examination. So let's get started with the extra oral examination. So starting with the extra oral examination, in the today's video we'll cover the extra oral examination. In that we'll see the skeletal pattern, the relationship of maxilla to the mandible and to the cranial base. So in three planes we'll see the anterior posterior plane, the lateral plane and the vertical plane. Transverse is the lateral plane, which we'll see. We'll also examine the soft tissues, in that we'll examine the lips, which is important for ortho, and the examination of tongue. Then we will do the examination of the speech, any temporomandibular joints and mandibular path of closure, and if any habits are present, that also we will study. Now the first and important thing you need to do in ortho is the seating position of the patient. Before you start with the extra oral examination, the very important thing which you need to consider is the seating of the patient. Now the patient should be seated upright and the head position, the postural position should be such that head should not rest first of all on the headrest. So patient should take the weight of his head on his own. And the second thing is the FH plane, which is the upper border of the external auditory meatus to the inner aspect of the bony orbit. So this is our FH plane. You can place your, you can use your fingers, you can take a stick. Actually a stick is very helpful in doing extra oral examination. So I am using a cardboard instead of a stick. So what you need to do is, for FH plane, see, this is, if this is the FH plane, then it should be parallel to the floor. So you need to see your FH plane of the patient, and this, the head should be positioned such that the patient is looking straight forward and the FH plane should be parallel to the floor. The lips should be in response and the teeth should be in the centric occlusion before you start your extra oral examination. Now coming to the anterior posterior jaw relationship, anterior posterior assessment. Now it can be done in two ways. You can use your, either you can use your fingers and you can use your stick. I am using a cardboard. Now the first method is you can use your fingers, and what you need to do is you need to place your index finger at point A and you need to use your middle finger at point B. Now for class 2 patients, the index finger, and if you place your index finger at point A and the middle finger at point B, now you need to see is my hand is pointing upwards for class 2 patient. Now for class 3 patient, my hand is pointing downward. So you need to see for class 1 relationship is your hand will be at the even positions. For class 2 patient, your hand is going to be pointing upward, and for class 3 patient, your hand is going to be pointing downward. The first one method is you can use your fingers. The another method for anterior posterior plane is you can take a card, you can take the stick or a cardboard. To do is take your stick covering the four points for anterior posterior points. Now the four points are the mid facial, the maxillary alveolar, the mandibular alveolar and your chin point. Now for class 1 relationship, mandibular lies 2 to 3 millimeter behind the maxilla. For class 2 relationships, when you place your stick at these points, the mandible is actually retruded in relation to the maxilla. Mandible will be behind the maxilla, and for class 3 relationship, your mandible is protruded in relationship to the maxilla. So you can examine the anterior posterior relationship in the two ways, either of it. Now this is not a very reliable method to do. So along with the anterior posterior relationship, we do all the examination. So coming to the vertical plane assessment, it is done in the two assessment, assessing the lower facial height or assessment of the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. If you remember in the cephalometric, so I make sure that you need to know cephalometric before you start with your case history. If you have not read the cephalometrics, I'll give you a link in the description below or up in the I button. Please make sure to read cephalometric before you start with your case history. Now we'll do the two assessments for vertical plane. The first one is we calculate the lower facial height, either it is normal, reduced or increased, and the second one is we assess the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. So assessment of the lower facial height we do in like faces divided into proportions, and the proportion we calculate if the lower facial height is increased or decreased. So how we calculate the proportion, we divide the face into three parts. So we take some lines or measurements to calculate the facial half. So the facial lower facial height. So how we calculate is, first we need to take the points or the lines. So the first line is the level of the hairline. The second line is the supra orbital ridge or our eye level of the eyebrows. The third we take is the base of the nose. And the last point we take is our inferior border of the chin, or where the base of the chin lies, in our interior aspect of the chin. Now these are the three parts of our face. These are the three proportion of the face. This is our facial proportion. This is somewhere for class 1 relationship it is equal. Now the lower facial height is our from the base of the nose to the inferior border of the chin. Now the lower facial height on an average are equal to the middle facial height, equal to the upper facial height. And then when we say our lower facial height is reduced, that means the lower facial height is less than the upper facial height. So this is how we calculate the lower facial height. This is an idea, you can access it from your eyes. Now the second assessment for the vertical is assessment of Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. If you need to go back in the cephalometrics and draw a Frankfurt our mandibular plane angle from the inferior border of our mandible, inferior border of the chin, to the Frankfurt horizontal line, to the FH plane, which we have drawn from a card. The easy thing to do is you can take your stick. I am taking a cardboard, so I'll be saying cardboard now. You will be taking a stick on the patient. Now you can take your stick, and one stick you can place on the FH plane and another stick you can place on the inferior border of the mandible. Now where these angles are meeting gives you the idea of assessment of Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. If you remember Tweed's analysis, we calculated Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. I'll give you a link in the description below and also up in the I button. So if you don't remember the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle, which was ideally was somewhere 25 degrees. Now you need to look for this angle. Normally these two planes meet at the occipital region. Now in case if these two planes are meeting beyond the occipital region, this means the patient is having a low plane angle, a low Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. Now this means the patient is a horizontal grower. Now if these two planes are meeting anterior to the occipital region, that means the patient is having a high plane angle or the patient is a vertical grower. Now, for the transverse assessment, what we need to do is you need to go behind the patient, stand behind the patient, and from above, from the head, you need to look at the patient's asymmetry. What you can do is you can go back and you can also take your stick, or I'm taking a cardboard, and you can place it at the midline, joining the midline and tip of the nose and tip of the chin, and you need to look for the symmetries and asymmetry. So you need to cover the midline of the nose, upper lip, lower lip, and the midpoint of chin, and that way you can assess the midlines. Now if any asymmetry is present, then you should also be noted that asymmetry. Now coming to the soft tissue examination, the examination of lips. Normally our upper lip covers the entire labial surface of the upper anteriors except 2 to 3 millimeters. So see the when patient is speaking, 2 to 3 millimeters of the incisor, upper incisor are, I have shifted the midline. So 2 to 3 millimeters of the upper incisor are visible when you see the upper lip, and when you see about the lower lip, 2 to 3 millimeters of the incisal edge of upper anteriors and little bit of incisal edge of lower anterior is visible. Now the lips can be classified into the competency of the lips. Actually a lip seal or the competency of the lips is achieved by contraction of our muscles which are near to our lips. So our, if you remember in the anatomy, the mentalis muscle and your orbicularis oris muscle provides a lip seal. Now if you see the competency or the lip seal is divided into, is classified into four types. The competent lips are the lips when at the slight, they are at the slight contact when the patient is relaxed. Now if you want to check the lip competency, first of all the patient is relaxed. When patient is sitting at the relaxed position, the lip slightly contact, both the lip, upper lip and lower lip slightly contact each other. And if you talk about the incompetent lips are when the lips do not provide a lip seal when the patient is at the relaxed position. Potentially incompetent lips are when you see a class 2 division 1 case when the patient is having rabbit teeth. So the teeth are coming front. So because of the upper anteriors are so proclined that patient is not able to close his lips, both the lips. So this case is the potentially incompetent lip when the patient is failed to provide a lip seal, failed to provide a lip closure. So this is the potentially incompetent lip where the lips are not providing the seal because of the interference of the proclined upper anterior. Then we have the fourth kind, which is the everted lips, when the lips are hypertrophied, and this is due to the weak muscular tonicity of the lips. Now we need to check the lip form and the fullness of the lips. Now if we talk about the form of the lips, then you need to see the vertical, average and the everted kind of lips, and you also need to check the fullness of the lip. Then you need to check for the lip if the lips are thin or if the lips are thick. Now coming to the examination of tongue, tongue actually comes under intraoral examination. I was thinking of covering clinical part, clinical examination in today's video, but it will be a lengthy video. So I am covering extraoral examination in today's video, and in the next video I will cover the intraoral examination. So you need to check any abnormalities in the tongue, as abnormality in the tongue can actually upset the muscular balance and the equilibrium, and it can cause malocclusion. So what you need to do is you need to ask the patient to protrude the tongue, and if you see any scalloped margin or any imprints on the tongue, if suppose this is a tongue and if you see any presence of imprints on the lateral margin of the tongue, it gives a scalloped appearance on the lateral margin of the tongue, then you can tell the patient is having a long turn or tongue. Or if you can ask the patient to touch the tip of the nose, and if the patient's tongue can reach the tip of the nose, then the patient is having a long tongue. Also, you need to check for two things, which is the mentolabial sulcus. As the name suggests, mentolabial sulcus is a concavity which is seen below the lower lip. So, a deep mentolabial sulcus is actually seen in the class 2 division 1. This is the deep mentolabial sulcus, where the sulcus is very deep. So this is seen in the class 2 division, and you can differentiate it from bimaxillary protrusion, as bimaxillary protrusion has shallow mentolabial sulcus. And also the second thing which you need to check on the face is the nasolabial angle. Now this nasolabial angle is the angle which is formed by connecting the two lines, as an angle is formed by connecting two lines, of course. So this line is the intersection of the line which connects the nose and the upper lip to the tip of the lip. So this is our nasolabial angle. Now normally the nasolabial angle for class 1 is 110 degrees. If you see for class 2 division 1, this nasolabial angle from the base of the nose to the tip of the tip of the lip to the upper lip to the tip of the lip, now this angle is reduced for class 2 division 1. In case of class 3 or in case of retrognathic maxilla, this angle is actually increased. So for class 1 it is 110 degrees, the nasolabial angle. The nasolabial angle is decreased for prognathic maxilla or class 2 division 1, and this angle is increased for retrognathic maxilla or our class 3 division. Certain malocclusion causes defect in their speech, and this is due to interference or the movement of tongue. For example, if a patient is having large tongue, or due to interference of the lips. So certain malocclusion actually causes some defect or some interference in their speech. Now this should be observed when asking journal question from the patient. While asking the case history, then you need to focus on the patient's speech as well. Now if the patient is having a tongue twist habit, then the speech is going to be a lisp. And if, for example, patient is a cleft lip patient, then the sound will come from the nose. So it will be kind of a nasal tone. Therefore, speech examination should also be done during asking the general questions from the patient. Also, you need to check the respiration. Now, humans have three types of breathing: the nasal breathing, oral and oronasal breathing. There are three simple tests I am going to tell you. There are many tests, but three simple tests I am going to tell you to check the respiration. Now, a mouth mirror test. The first one is, you need to place a mouth mirror in front, in between the patient nose and the patient mouth. If you are placing the mirror end of the mouth mirror towards the nasal end, and if the nasal end or the mirror end of the mouth mirror forms, so that means the patient is a nasal breather. Or if the oral side is fogged, that means the patient is an oral breather. The other test is the cotton test. Actually, this is done for unilateral nasal blockage. Now, this test is, you need to take some amount of cotton, the butterfly. You need to make the butterfly shape cotton, and it is placed over the upper lip, and this is below the nostrils. So you need to place this cotton, butterfly shaped cotton, on the upper bit between the upper lip and the nose. Now if this cotton flutters down, that means the patient is a nasal breather. The third test is very simple test, water test. You just need to ask the patient to fill the mouth with water, and if the patient can retain the water for a long period of time, that means the patient is a nasal breather. For mouth breathers, they cannot take water for a long time and they find it very difficult. So these all are the simple test to assess the breathing of or respiration of a patient. The next you need to examine is the temporomandibular joint. You need to check for the opening and the lateral movements of the temporomandibular joint, and it should be checked by first observing the patient from the front and then palpating the condylar heads of the patient, and try to listen to the presence of any crepitus or any clicking sound if present. Now the maximal mouth opening should be determined or measured. We do it like, we ask the patient to place four fingers inside the mouth, and if the patient is able to place his four fingers inside the mouth, that means the patient is having a normal mouth opening. The maximal mouth opening is normal, which is usually 40 to 45 millimeters for adults. Now the mandibular path of closure, which is very easy. Actually, this is the path in which a patient is closing the mandible, in which the patient is going to the habitual occlusion. So the path of closure is the movement of mandible from the rest to the habitual occlusion. Now this is very easy. Actually, you need to check for the patient how the patient is closing the mouth. You need to observe it closely. Now there will be a forward path of closure. That means when the patient is going to close the mouth here, now a patient is going to close the mouth here. So there is a forward path of closure. The path of closure, the patient is taking the mandible forward to close the mouth. Now this happens in when the patient is having a class 3 occlusion, when where the patient is having edge to edge incisor. Normally the upper incisor are 2 to 3 millimeter ahead of the lower incisors, right? Now for this case, the forward path of closure, well, the patient will be having edge to edge relationship of incisors. The incisor will contact edge to edge. There will be a forward path of closure. The patient is going to close the mouth forward. The closing of mouth will be, the path will be a little bit forward. Now the path of closure is backward. Patient was supposed to close the mouth here. Okay, normal circumstances. Now backward path of closure is when the patient is closing the mouth backward in the back. Now this happens when the patient's incisor maxillary incisors are proclined and he's retruding the mandible and closing the mouth backward. So this happens in the class 2 division 2 cases. There is a backward path of closure. Now lateral path of closure is when the patient was supposed to close the mouth, there is a midline, is supposing to close the mouth in bilateral symmetrical. Now when the patient is taking the mandible to one side and closing it, so there is a shift from either it is to left side or it is to right side. The patient is closing the mouth laterally. This happens when there is occlusal prematurity presence in one side of the dental arch. There is lateral path of closure. So you also need to check for habits, if any habits are present in the patient. Actually, you don't have to seat a patient for a while to check the habits. There are some telltale signs which tells you that the patient is having a thumb sucking habit or any habit. For example, if the patient is having a proclined maxilla, let me draw it. If you are placing a thumb inside, if a patient is placing a thumb inside, so these are the upper incisor, these are the lower incisors, right? Now if a patient is constantly sucking the thumb, okay, that patient is having a thumb sucking habit, then the upper incisor, because of the force of the thumb, the upper incisor are going to be proclined, the lower incisor are going to be retroclined, and there will be a open bite. In that case, the patient is having an incomplete overbite or an open bite. These are some signs which you can tell it from the patient intraoral examination about the habit, and also if you check the patient's finger or patient's palm or the digit, you can calculate the patient is having a thumb sucking habit. So that's pretty much about the extraoral examination. In the next video, we'll cover the intraoral examination. If you have any questions about it, you can leave it in the comment below. Give it a thumbs up if you like the video. Make sure to subscribe to Dental Pathshala if you want to get more videos like this, and I'll see you next time.